Hi everyone, I'm Brad Keelor, the director of the Geo-Institute, and welcome to the 100th episode of Director's Cut. Before we get to the interview, I just want to take a minute and say thank you to everyone who entered our contest to ask a question to Jim Mitchell. I also want to say thanks to everybody who's appeared on the show over the last couple of years, and everybody who's watched, even if it's just one episode one time. Thank you for making this such a hit. I did not think it would last more than 10 or 12 episodes, but because people watch, we keep doing it. It's a lot of fun. Please send us any feedback you have on the show, and we're going to keep on going. So here's to another 100 episodes. Enjoy this week's show. I am Brad Keelor. He is Jim Mitchell. Next up on Director's Cut on our 100th episode, find out not one, but two winners for the 100th episode contest. Again, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Director's Cut. My name is Brad Keelor. I'm the director of the Geo Institute, and that is why we call this show Director's Cut. Every single week, I sit down with a different GI member who has stories to tell. Some of them are personal, some are professional, and all of them are fun. If you don't know anything about the Geo Institute, we are a technical society. We have about 12,000 members, most of whom are geotechnical engineers and or geologists, and we are part of the American Society of Civil Engineers. If you like what you see today, and I think you will, you should click like and subscribe and get notifications, and we will let you know every time we post something to the YouTube channel. Today, we have a special treat. It is episode number 100. Unless you have been living in a cave, you probably know that by now because we've been talking about it a lot lately. And we welcome for episode 100 from his home in Western Massachusetts, Geo-Legend Jim Mitchell. Jim, welcome.
Thank you, Brad. Pleasure to be here.
I think we're going to have a great time today. We have 10 questions. I mean, I guess we could have done 100 for the 100th episode, but that might have taken a little long. So we're going to start with one of the two that we ask everybody, and you're going to have to get a little creative with this one. Describe your job in 45 seconds.
Well, I don't officially have a job because I think I'm supposed to be retired, but in fact, I'm not. So what is occupying me and keeping me awake at night these days is preparing the fourth edition of my book on fundamentals of soil behavior. And each edition seems to be more challenging than one that went before. People who are familiar with the book will know that the third edition, we were fortunate enough to bring Kenichi Soga on board to help because I realized that so much had gone on. There's so many new things and so many smart people who know those things and I don't. I needed help. And so that worked out very nicely. And when the publisher decided that they maybe would like to go ahead and try a fourth edition, Kenichi and I jointly said, you know, there's so much that's happened that we can't really keep up with it all, and we need somebody young, and we need somebody smart, and that's the way we ought to go after this new assignment. And so we scratched our heads, and we came up with a super choice, and that is Professor Catherine O'Sullivan, who is a faculty member at Imperial College in London, UK. And she's joined us in bringing a tremendous talent to the table in helping to get this book in shape for the fourth edition. So we're delighted to have her. And we are fighting a deadline, but hopefully we'll manage it and have it behind us.
So for each one of those additions, is there a moment where you sat down and you said, whoa, I really need to get to work on updating this? I think, you know, when you're a student, you kind of see it the other way. You think, oh, they're just doing it to make some more money off the book. But you get older and you realize that's not actually what's happening.
So no, for you don't do it.
As the author, for the money.
Right? What
pushes you to start that process again?
Well, we were invited to do it by the publisher, and we thought about it for a while and decided, well, let's give it a go. It's some new material that needs to be covered, and we'll see if we can't get through it one more time. But by no means do we do it for the money. I've estimated this over the years of the fourth editions, and my time in there is worth maybe a nickel an hour.
We have to ask fun questions on Director's Cut too, although that was a pretty fun answer. I got to give you credit for that one. Not everybody makes that question a fun answer. In your life, do you have a memorable home improvement success or disaster?
Well, we have a home improvement success that had its origin in a disaster. And that was about 10 years ago. I was living in the southwestern part of Virginia then, in Blacksburg. And we had a storm which is called a derecho. And a derecho is like a tornado, except instead of spinning, the wind comes through in a straight line, and it just goes whoosh right through the area that's affected. And this derecho took some shingles off our roof, and by the time we assessed it all and got ready to put it all back together, we found that the insurance was going to cover quite a bit of this. And so we were able to handle the total re-roofing of the house without too much out-of-pocket expense. And so that's what made the disaster a success. And we had the house re-roofed.
And that was an exciting night for many reasons. I remember this. And we camped out in the living room so that we wouldn't be directly under any trees that might fall on the house or anything. And the kids thought that it was fun for some reason, I guess because they weren't in their bedrooms. But it was so quick and caused so much damage. I mean, do you have any other memories from that storm?
Well, it took a lot of trees down in our neighborhood. And so there was a lot of time spent and effort spent getting those cut up and out of the way and getting things back to normal. So that was basically what I remember about that particular storm.
And I, for one, am very happy that we have not had another derecho since that night. Usually the third question is the research question, and that's what we're going to do here. I didn't know where to start in writing a research question for you because you've kind of done a lot in your career, Jim. You're very humble, but you've done a lot of different stuff. So I'm going to let you guide this one, and maybe you can talk about a couple of interesting things you've done or why you ended up doing some of the research you did, or I'm just going to let you take it away.
Well, I've worked on a number of different things, and they've been motivated differently along the way. I remember thinking about preparing for this particular thing we're doing now, I went all the way back to think about, well, what did I work on first when I left the Army where I had been and went out to Berkeley for my first faculty job? And that was interesting. And I remember that I was both a assistant professor and an assistant research engineer in the Institution for Transportation and Traffic Engineering. And the director of the institute, a professor named Harmer Davis, was also teaching one of the soil mechanics courses. And he said, you know, Mitchell, what you ought to do is figure out how to make hardpan. That would be a great contribution in the field of soil stabilization if you could make hardpan. Well, I thought about it and I said, no, nature makes hardpan. I don't know how to do it. I have no idea. But it did get me going in the evaluation of soil stabilization for various purposes. And that's something that remained with me throughout my whole career working with soil cement and other additives for treating soils. But a number of my research activities just sort of happened. I knew we were going to start a course at Berkeley on what we were calling in those days physical chemical aspects of soil behavior. And my colleague and mentor at Berkeley, Harry Seed, had worked on a number of things with compacted soils, and he got interested in studying thixotropic hardening of compacted clays. And I set to work trying to figure out the fundamentals of this thixotropic hardening. And that was one research activity. And one thing leads to another. And I learned a lot from students that were working with me on their own doctoral research and things like that. And I remember that one of the creative and most bright students that I had the privilege of working with, Donald Gray, who went on to a long career at the University of Michigan, was working on aspects of soil permeability and electroosmosis and things of that sort. And that got me started in that particular direction. And then chance activities. I know you have a question, I think, coming up later about involvement with ASCE and the GI. And one thing that happened directly as a result of ASCE in the early years was my interest in studying lunar soils, which we knew very little about in those days. And the president of ASCE challenged all the committees within ASCE to think about what they could do that would help in the project that was then getting underway to get people to the moon and back safely by the end of the decade. Of course, this was in the mid-60s when this happened. And at that point, I was on a committee in ASCE, the Soil Properties Committee. And I said, you know, well, that sounds interesting. Why don't we see if we can get together all the information that we know about the moon? We hadn't been there yet at all. But at least get started. Well, that started me in the whole area of lunar soils and their properties and their behavior and what was going on up there and how to get more information. And out of that came research on soil penetration and a number of things like that. And so I went off in that direction. And this is along the lines of following what Yogi Berra once said, which he says, when you come to a fork in the road, take it. And things would come up, and I'd do it. And so it sort of went on through my research career, and I got very interested in soil penetration resistance and the properties of unusual soils and coupled flows and a number of things that I've worked in over the years.
So do you have anything that now you look back and you kind of can't believe that you did? And not necessarily because it was, I mean, I guess it could be because it was challenging. But I'm thinking more just something that you look back on and you're like, wow, I can't believe I was involved in that.
Oh. Well, I can look back and at the work I was doing on things related to soil chemistry and mineralogy and all that kind of stuff. And one of the things that came out of that is a lot of our, what is going on now, approaches to dealing with geo-environmental problems and wastes and waste containment facilities and things of that sort, because a lot of the things that we were working more in the abstract back in the old days became very, very relevant to what was going on in the new geo-environmental field.
Well, that was a fantastic answer, and thanks for walking everybody through that. I know it's ultra condensed, but that trip through your research career, that was fantastic. You are, of course, a geo-legend. You were the very first episode of our video, Geo-Legends, and you've been in the print one as well. What geo-legend did you miss interacting with the most? It can be somebody that you didn't get to work with at all, or maybe somebody you didn't get to work with, in your opinion, enough, but somebody you missed interacting with the most.
Yeah, well, I think there are a lot of people that would fit that description. But the one individual that had the most impact, I think, on my own activities and what I've done and the success I've had, has been the late Harry Bolton Seed. Harry Seed is the individual who brought me to Berkeley in the first place. And we became very close friends and colleagues. And he worked, of course, he's best known as his work as the father of geotechnical earthquake engineering. And he developed all of the stuff that was so now, it's important now, during the years that I was there. I was not working specifically in that area, but we were in constant contact. And he's the one who always, he inspired me. And we talked about all manner of things in our program there at Berkeley. And worked together just on the activities within the geotechnical program. And he had great insights and great consideration, compassion for all of his friends and colleagues, and just was he was just outstanding. And we could talk about anything, and I could learn from it, and admired him both as a colleague and as a friend.
And a great way to sum it up there. And we're going to talk a little bit more as we get later in the show about a couple of other geo-legends. But now we have to move on to something that I think was very important to this interview. You are sort of legendary, at least within the geotech community, for being a musician. And I know you've played music for a long time. What is the first piece of music that you remember mastering?
Well, I would say first that I'm not sure I ever mastered any song, but I loved playing, and unfortunately, my activities in that area were shut down by the pandemic, March of 2020. Just shut down the groups. I was playing with a community band, and I was playing in big band, jazz band, swing band. And they were sort of the highlights of my non-working existence, playing in those bands. But I got to thinking about the first sort of solo performance that I ever made. And this was back, I think, in grade school. And they had this crazy arrangement in the assembly auditorium for the school and set me up to play this song on a sort of a stepped approach to the stage, and they had a wire music stand and the music on it, and there I sat precariously playing whatever I was playing, and all of a sudden the music stand and the music fell over, thing which brought a big halt to it all, and I reached down and grabbed it and said, "Oh," expletive deleted, and marched off the stage. And that was my first performance.
That's pretty good. How old were you at that point?
I might have been about 10 or 12 or something of that sort.
That's all, but they stuck you on the, so you had no chance to make it through that. That's... Oh, well. I'm going to guess the second performance probably went a lot better.
A lot better, yeah. But anyhow, playing in the bands was always fun.
So you did mention this earlier that we were going to ask. We ask every guest how they got first involved in ASCE and GI, and that's the whole question. How did you start to get involved in ASCE and then, I guess, probably the geotechnical division and then GI?
Yeah, back when I got involved in there was no GI. There was a soil mechanics and foundations division of ASCE. But I'm sure it was back when I was still a student. And it was one of those things you did. You got involved in the activities of the student chapter of ASCE and the subjects that you were interested in and so on. And it was just sort of one of the things you did. And so I got involved with the executive committee of the Soil Mechanics and Foundation Engineering Division. The forerunner of the Board of Governors, I guess, but we were a group of about five or six for all the years, and things were much more informal, but we struggled along, and that changed in the mid-90s with the creation of the Geo-Institute. And I remember that was back when Larry Roth was with ASCE and then sort of had these, he was mightily involved anyhow in getting a meeting together of a whole bunch of us. And out of it came the Geo-Institute back in the middle 90s.
And we're still making it today. I was pretty happy when we had that 25th anniversary a few years ago, and we're still going strong. And it's thanks to people like you for building it up and keeping it going all these years. So as everybody knows too, you spent many years in Blacksburg. I live on the opposite corner of the state, up near Washington, D.C., and Blacksburg is an interesting place, and I know my experience with it now is my son runs cross country and track and everything, and whenever we see that Blacksburg High School is going to be at a meet, all the kids are kind of like, oh, because they know that Blacksburg's going to steamroll everybody. If you had to write a Blacksburg travel brochure, what would the headlines be that you would put on it? How would you attract people?
Sort of a tongue-in-cheek headline that I'd put in there is, well, Blacksburg's not at the ends of the earth, but you can see them from there. But I'd also put on there that Blacksburg is really a very beautiful place. It's in the Blue Ridge Mountains. It is a great town to live in. It's a great town to raise a family in. Now, I can't speak for my own family because I raised them in California before I went to Blacksburg. But I know from the other people that I've known in Blacksburg that they all agree that it's very good in that regard. It's easy. It's an easy place to live, and it's just comfortable. And the university is doing really well these days, and got a lot going for it. They're doing very well, except on the football field. I would take note of all those things on my travel brochure.
I always think there are not a lot of places that you can drive on a freeway in the United States, and it's very scenic. Once you start getting down into Southwest Virginia, I-81 is a nice drive, and I've always enjoyed making that trip, especially at this time of year in the fall. Yeah.
Yeah. Spring and fall.
So we ran a contest for people to ask questions to Jim for this 100th episode, and I said we were going to pick a winner. Well, we got a bunch of entries, and we decided we were going to pick two winners. And so we've got two winning questions now, and the first one comes from Jack Lawrence, who asked, in your Geo-Legends interview, you discussed being educated under Terzaghi and Casa Grande. As the field of geotechnical engineering uses more and more computational tools, do you think the industry has lost sight of the importance of basic engineering geology skills, which Terzaghi and Casa Grande advocated heavily for?
Yeah, and that's a provocative question in some ways, but I think for many geotechnical activities, geology is certainly playing a well and deserved and necessary role. I am a little bit distressed that engineering geology is not a required course in most civil engineering programs or even some geotechnical programs. And it is difficult to get people specialized in that area, but the contributions that are there are just immeasurable. I know of a couple of universities who've made a concerted effort to hire somebody to just focus on geological engineering within the geotechnical programs, and they haven't been successful. And this is recently. They're just not out there. So it's a little bit disappointing that there's so much difficulty in attracting people. But certainly there are good engineering geologists in practice. And I took a course, one of my first graduate courses at MIT was taken up at Harvard, and it was taught by Carl Terzaghi, and it was engineering geology. It was a great course, obviously. I still have my notes. And matter of fact, when I went to MIT as a graduate student, my supervisor was Professor Bill Lamb, T.W. Lamb.
Oh, wow.
He at the time was quite enthusiastic about geology and its importance. And the first summer I was there, I was a research assistant, and I had to take a class in the summertime, sort of a self-study class. He said, "You go over and see Professor Robert Schrock in geology, and see about putting together a self-study course for the summer." And he, Lamb, and Schrock sort of supervised this course. And just out of the interest, I turned around and sitting on my shelf, and I'll get it right here. Here's the report.
Wow.
From that course, correlation of the engineering properties of soil with its geologic history. It turns out there's stuff in this thing that I put together. It's just in early summer of, in the summer of my first year as a graduate student. There's stuff in here that found its way into my book the first time I wrote it. So I've been sort of a believer in the importance of geology. And then another point of interest in that regard, Bill Lamb, as I said, was my academic advisor as a graduate student. And I had put my program together with a major was going to be in soil mechanics and a couple of minors. And I said, you know, I really would like to take some courses in mathematics, because my mathematical skills are terrible. I took four courses as an undergraduate that were required, got an A in them all, and I don't remember learning a thing. From the standpoint of a deep understanding in those classes, I really need to get some. He said, no, you take geology. You can always hire a mathematician. That was his. I'm not sure I totally agree with that now, but anyhow, I wound up taking geology, and that course from with Terzaghi was a part of the minor that I had. And this course here, the self-study course, was another part of it. I don't regret those things. I think that thinking geotechnical engineers are always going to have to turn to geology to after all, everything we do with in our field is built on with soils and rocks. So we've got to know something about that.
So before we get to the other winning question, I do have one quick follow-up here that I didn't put in the original questions. I'm wondering if there was a course in undergrad that particularly inspired you? And it may not have even been an engineering course. Is there something you look back on that really was foundational to you in a lot of the work that you did?
Well, I did my undergraduate at RPI, Rensselaer. And I think our courses, once we had decided the areas of specialization in civil engineering, were so prescribed that I had about two electives in my 4 years. And one of them that I took was called water power engineering, just because I was interested in it. And the other was public speaking. I profited by both courses, but I would say probably more by the speaking course than the others.
That's great. And that's a good endorsement for people to go do. I mean, I think a lot of people, especially in technical and scientific fields, don't necessarily think, oh, this is going to be something that's valuable to me. But, you know, when you get up and you got to give that first presentation when you're a grad student, I bet that paid dividends immediately for you. Yeah. Oh, that's a good answer. So the other winning question that we had came from Pouya, Pishgah. And their question is, we're going to hit on all the geo legends today, I feel like, because this might be a Ralph Peck answer here. Engineering judgment has always played an important role in geotechnical engineering. How can young engineers get the ability to make engineering judgment, and how can they develop and improve this ability?
Yeah, it's like common sense, isn't it? And not everybody has the same ability or the same amount of common sense. And it has to be learned in many cases. I've heard it said, there's nothing like a failure to help improve your engineering judgment.
Yeah.
But we sort of would like to avoid those. And I think a good place to start is with the observational method. Of course, the observational method has been formalized now because of greater understanding of things into a series of steps that Peck listed in his, I guess it was his, was it his Rankin lecture? What is his lecture anyhow? We have this approach to the observational method, but we've learned a lot too that I think enhances it through risk assessments and adaptive management of projects, where you sort of always have something in mind that you're going to do if what your plans you've made already don't work out and things of that sort. And I think we have computational skills that we didn't have before that can be another great aid to your judgment. But you've got to have an appreciation for what can go wrong if things don't go right.
Mm-hmm.
And that really is what the observational method is all about. And with today's computational and risk reliability work, movement towards a performance-based design and all of these things, they all have in there this real core of some judgment, because in the end it comes right back to you on how you're going to proceed. That's sort of a rambling answer, but it's always something worth thinking about.
And I think that's probably a pretty tough question to come up with one direct answer for, but it was a good question. And thanks to everybody who entered that contest and submitted your questions. We really appreciate it. We have one question left for you, Jim, and we're back to mine now. You are, of course, a Terzaghi Lecture alumni. I don't know if that's the right term. We're coming up on the 60th anniversary of the Terzaghi Lecture here. The 60th anniversary one will be given in Los Angeles in March at Geo-Congress. Your lecture was, I believe, 1984. How do you feel the Terzaghi Lecture has changed over the years?
Well, first off, I think that it's understood or perceived to be a very prestigious lecture and a great honor to be asked to deliver the Terzaghi Lecture. I was close to the formulation of the ground rules of some things like that way back, and I know that those who drafted what you read in the rules and regulations for these things indicate that it's to be delivered by the founders of the whole thing. When they put the thing together, they set up two awards. One was the Terzaghi Lecture and the other was the Terzaghi Award. And in the mind of that group, the more prestigious of the two would be the Terzaghi Award. But what I think has happened in the minds of the GI members and in the awards committee and everything else over the years is this: they've sort of reversed that. I think the Terzaghi Lecture is viewed as the ultimate within the profession. In terms of you want to call prestige or whatever, the honor of the award. So I think that's been sort of the evolution. That's how it's changed. But I think that no matter who it is that's invited to deliver the Terzaghi Lecture, they take it extremely seriously and they work hard on it. And long on it, and it paid off because by and large it's been a collection of really fine presentations and of great value to the profession. So I think it's something that those who have been fortunate enough to be invited are very, very, very pleased and honored, and I think the profession has benefited by having a lot of new information and insights.
Do you have any specific memories from your lecture, either in the preparation of it, the giving of the lecture, or something that happened to you afterwards because of the lecture?
Well, no, I remember working very, very hard. Getting some input and insights from friends and colleagues as I was putting it together. I don't know, it's just a year or two of my career
that
was dedicated to that. So I think that the Terzaghi Lecture and the Rankin Lecture are considered the two of the high points in geotechnical field.
That is fantastic. Jim, you made it through all the questions, including the ones that were submitted from our viewers. So fantastic job. Yeah. For our viewers, this was, of course, episode number 100. We are not ending Director's Cut. Don't worry about that. Hopefully we'll have another 100 episodes. So to everybody who watched today, thank you. And for all our viewers, again, if you liked what you saw, and I always say you're here at the end, so you probably did, click like, subscribe, get notifications, and we will always let you know every time we post something to the YouTube channel. So Jim, thank you so much.
Thank you, Brad.
I hope this was a good time.
Yep.
And for all our viewers, we will see you with a brand new Director's Cut next week.